good morning. We are glad that you are here with us this morning. And as you might have guessed, the first part of our series in the promise is the promise of peace. And I invite you to turn in your Bibles to, we're actually going to be in three different passages primarily. So maybe you want to mark it, or you can just try to keep up, or it should be on the screen for you. But we'll be in Isaiah chapter 9 first. That's where we'll be first. And then we'll go to Luke chapter 2, and then we'll finish up in Colossians chapter 1. So what we see in Isaiah chapter 9, Isaiah is a prophet, and he's primarily writing to, if you look at verse 1, he's primarily writing to cities that had been devastated by war. The Assyrians had come in, and they had been ravished by war, and he's writing, and what he's writing to them is a hope of a Messiah. That there was going to be a new day. It wasn't going to stay like that. So he's hopeful in it. And so this is what it says in Isaiah chapter 9, starting in verse 2. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of tramping warrior in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Let's pray. Father, we come to you humbly, knowing that you are the living God, and that what we are looking at is your living word, the Bible. And we ask you, Holy Spirit, that you would do a work that only you can accomplish, that you would open our eyes to see, that you would expose in areas of our lives where we don't have peace, or for those that don't know you, that they don't have peace with you, and that you would then in a way be able to take us to how to transform our lives by living out your word. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen. As we talk about peace this time of year, we talk about it a lot, but really there can be a lack of peace, especially, you know, that day after Thanksgiving you have the Black Friday, and then it just can be very stressful. If you think about the Black Friday deals, a couple weeks ago I was talking about how the Black Friday just kind of expanded over, a month and a half. But when you think back to, kids you might not, or students you might not even recognize this or know this, I was trying to explain it to my kids a few weeks back of just the absolute chaos of a Black Friday, when people are waiting out in the cold, maybe overnight, maybe at least for a few hours, in order to get a good deal on like a 40-inch TV. I think I've only been a part of one, really. Was my wife and I had just gotten married. We were in Traverse City, Michigan, and we went to Target, and we waited just a couple hours. We didn't wait overnight or anything, but we waited in line at Target for a couple of hours in the cold to get a GPS, right? Before Google Maps, you had the thing that you stick on your window, and we didn't have that much money, but we got a good deal on this one. But even that, just trying to get a GPS, there was jostling and bodies pushing. I remember one lady being really angry at a cashier. It was wild, right? It's not very peaceful. Even just go down the street now in Batavia. Like, Main Street's always kind of chaotic, but you get into like the weekend and get closer to Christmas, it's absolute chaos. It's not peaceful. And then bring in family, and there just can be, it doesn't feel that peaceful. Between the traffic and the shopping and the busyness, it can be kind of frustrating. And maybe you feel kind of like this video here.
You're frustrated?
I'm frustrated.
You're frustrated?
Yeah.
You're frustrated too? Mm-hmm. Oh, tell me.
Look at me.
I'm frustrated.
You're frustrated?
Yeah.
Why are you frustrated?
I'm frustrated.
Oh, you are?
Yeah. I'm frustrated. I'm frustrated.
You're frustrated too?
Why are you frustrated?
Oh no, Anna says she is. Are you too?
Yeah, I'm frustrated.
Life can be frustrating sometimes. It can be stressful. Maybe you know what that is like. We know the reality that we don't always feel peace. We feel frustrated. We don't feel settled. We feel stressed. And so it doesn't take too much convincing to see that we have a need for peace. That can be at this time of year, but if we look around, we know that there isn't peace. I get an email every day or during the week every day, and it gives me the quick hits of important news from around the world. And here's just a few of them, a handful of the quick hits of the top news stories from this past week. China is set to loosen COVID restrictions after days of protests. Ethiopia peace process undermined as forces continue attacking civilians. Revealed 6,500 migrant workers have died in Qatar since the World Cup was awarded there. Canada is set to expand assisted death. 9 civilians are killed in a militant siege of a hotel. And explosions in Jerusalem kill one and injure at least 15. It's just a handful of quick hits from an email. And as one person said, the world today knows no settled peace. We'd be accurate if we were to acknowledge that it's not just today that this has been true, but it's very similar to what we see in Isaiah 9. In Isaiah 9, when Isaiah is anticipating a Messiah, a day that there wouldn't be violence. It's what we would wish for, hope for. In verse 5, where it says, "For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire." So in the context of war and oppression, he focuses on this coming Messiah, and that all the bits and all the pieces, all the things that you're needed for war, the boots and the garments, will then be used as fuel for fire. They'll be irrelevant eventually. And the reason why Isaiah says this is, he says, "For to us a child is born, and us a son is given." In other words, the answer to everything that's going on, everywhere there's not peace, is directly tied to the birth of a baby. But not just any baby, but this baby that will be the Prince of Peace. If we summarize what Isaiah provides us with in these verses, it simply says this. He says, a child is born, and that child is the Prince of Peace. And if we would have peace, it is to that child we must go. And there is no peace except that which is found in him. It's quite the claim if you think about it. That all the dilemma of mankind, that all the hostility, the enmity, the strife, all the violence, the frustration of broken relationships, all of that, the hope that there could be peace, is found in a baby. And because we can sense this need for peace, the fact that there would be a Prince of Peace should be quite appealing to each of us. And I don't think it would just be found in that we wish that there was peace in the world. There was no more violence. There was no more war, although that might be true that we would hope for that. But we'd also sense it in that we want peace amongst ourselves. Right, in our relationships, we would want peace to be there. Right, especially you got family coming over. You're going to family gatherings, and there's this tension. There's broken relationships. There's hardship there. It's not something that you want to enter into, but because we know when there's those things going on, it leaves a bad taste in our mouth. We want to be out of that. We don't want to be a part of that. So we would want peace amongst ourselves. But it's not just out there. It's easy to look out there and look, we need peace amongst one another. But really, the desire that we need to have is that, and recognize, is that we need peace within ourselves. See, there could be tranquility all around us. There could be peace around us. And yet there can still be this gnawing sense of the raging torment that we don't have peace in us. It needs to be peace within ourselves. Doesn't take much convincing to see that we need peace. And despite man's ability to accumulate things, stuff, accumulate knowledge, peace is not found there. It's not found in a trip to the mall or a purchase on Amazon. It's not available because you have a degree, you have a good job. It's expressed in the book of Ecclesiastes. Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, chased after everything, and yet at the end of it all, he realized it leads to a dead end. It doesn't lead to peace. It's expressed, the need for peace is expressed in all different ways. We hear it in music. I don't know about you and where you land on which side of this issue, but in the Dawson house, Christmas begins the day after Halloween. And so we have been listening to Christmas music for weeks now. And you listen to the music, and there's some that are extremely annoying. And there's a song that I just heard this past week again. And here are the lyrics. No more lives torn apart, that wars would never start, and time would heal all hearts, and everyone would have a friend, and right would always win, and love would never end. Right, that's the grown-up Christmas wish or Christmas list. It's expressed by a comedian who in 1995 said this: we've cleaned up the air but polluted the soul. We've conquered the atom but not our prejudice. We write more but learn less. We plan more, we accomplish less. These are times of fast foods and slow digestion, big men and small character, steep profits and shallow relationships. The days of two incomes but more divorce, fancier houses but broken homes. The days of quick trips, disposable diapers, throwaway morality, one-night stands, overweight bodies, and pills that do everything from cheer to quiet to kill. It's a time when there is much in the showroom window, but nothing in the stockroom. And the book of Isaiah gives a promise of the coming of the Prince of Peace, which, turning to Luke chapter 2, we see the announcement of peace. See the announcement of peace. Luke chapter 2, verse 8 through 14. And it says this: and in the same region there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, who is Christ, a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. The announcement of peace from the beginning, and the fact that there was going to be good news, is proclaimed. We'll talk about Zechariah next week, I believe, but it's proclaimed to Zechariah. This announcement of peace is proclaimed to the strangest people, people that you wouldn't expect. Zechariah, who he says, we're too old to have a baby. It was going to be John the Baptist. We're too old to have a baby, right? And then it's told to Mary, a teenage girl, and to Joseph, a carpenter. And here it comes, this message, this proclamation that there is hope, that there's going to be peace, that there is good news, now comes to shepherds in a field. The Prince of Peace is coming, is proclaimed to shepherds, which shows the availability of this peace. The angel says that it's good news for all people. It's not first announced to the powerful or the perfect. It's not announced to the clean and the polished and to those that have everything together. The announcement comes to dirty, smelly shepherds in a field at night. Shepherds aren't known for their standing in culture. They aren't known for the security that they have in a beautiful home or a nice dwelling place. They're not known for their fancy attire. They aren't known for their religious prowessness. They don't know a lot. Rather, the availability of peace is announced to those that were in need of it, but maybe even thought that they weren't deserving of it. Maybe that's you today. I don't know the background that you have in your life. I don't know what you've gone through this week. I don't know what you did. I don't know what websites you visited or what you did with your time. But maybe you're here thinking that you're not deserving of the peace that God is offering. Well, you're in good company for two reasons. You're here with a bunch of other broken people, and we see the announcement here is to a bunch of dirty shepherds in a field, people that you would think they might not deserve it. But I think there's two responses that can come when we hear that there's good news for everyone and that there could be peace. I think there's two responses that people can have. I once heard these responses described by using these great theologians, the Beatles. But the response number one is that we can work it out. We can work it out. It's really this self-reliance. We see that there's a need. We feel that there's a need for peace. We might even see and have been to church. We know that we've heard of this Prince of Peace. And that peace is offered. And say, I can figure this out myself. I can fix this dilemma. Or you see that it's peace to who God, it's on who God's favor rests. So that means that if I can earn God's favor, I can do enough, I can earn my way. I have the resources, I have the intellectual ability, I live in proximity to a church, I can do it. This person might even admit that while their life isn't perfect, maybe it isn't that bad. Especially when you compare it to that other person. They might acknowledge that they have some messes. Yeah, not every the relationship is perfect. They have troubles and they have pain. But don't worry, we can work it out. And sadly, this is typically the answer that most people come to. They see that there's a problem. They understand, they feel the lack of peace in their life. But since they can work it out, the way they do this is they look inside of themselves for the answer. Maybe it's in their religion. But what their life really shows that their faith is in themselves. And so they look deeper into themselves. And this is what our culture portrays. This is what they say we need to do. Look inside yourself to find the answer to the lack of peace that's there. And so it might be that they need to look inside because they're not listening enough to themselves. Or maybe that and so they're not listening, so they're not going to feel peace until they have that inner sense that what they've been longing for, and they can go off and do anything they want. Or maybe it's that somebody else is hindering their peace, right? They look in themselves and they say, no, I want that, and somebody's in my way of peace, and so they do whatever they want to get rid of that. And the thing about this is there's no verifiable, there's no objective truth there. Because what happens is I look inside myself and what might be true this moment in 10 years might not be true anymore. Because I'm shifting, right? I find peace in something or a facade of peace at on some level. It feels good. I get affirmed. Maybe on Facebook, I can get people to say, great job. Yes, go for that. You get friends to affirm that. And you know what? It shifts. What we're told is to continue to look in. Continue to look within yourself. To find peace. And so I think we could probably all agree that if we don't see it in ourselves, we can easily see it in other people. We're pretty good at picking out their faults, but see it in ourselves that there is a strong strain of individual self-reliance that is in our, if not in our lives, and around us. There's a strong strain of individual self-reliance. So response number one is that I can work it out, right? That we can work it out. But the Beatles also had a song, and the other response is, I think the only other response, it's either we can do it ourselves or it's help. I need somebody. I need somebody else. This is the person who says, I've looked inside, but I need somebody outside of myself. I've tried to work it out. I've tried to find the answer to peace. I've tried to look within, and it's not there. I've searched and I've come to the conclusion that I need someone outside of myself to fix the mess that I'm in. And we got to hear that the last couple of weeks. Right before the people were baptized last week, didn't we hear them say this very thing? That whether, didn't matter what age they were, younger or older, the truth was still there that they were in a mess. And they came to the realization that they needed to look outside of themselves to find rescue that they needed. And that is the message of the Bible. That is the message of Christmas. And instead of men and women finding their way to God, what we see in the Christmas story is that God is in the business of finding and rescuing people that are lost and in need of rescue. He takes the initiative in the lives of men and women. Isaiah 9, when it says, for unto us a son is given. That's what we see. That God is taking the initiative and rescuing people. See, God's favor is not on those that say that they can work it out, but rather on people that are in desperation because of their recognition that they are in need of help. They are in need of peace that they can't get themselves. And the peace that is spoken of here is not just a temporary peace. Right? We know that even in strained relationships, there can be a time of maybe restoration and there's peace, but that could be fleeting on a personal level. Or we know that there's ceasefire agreements that last for just a short time. Even in that news article that was about, hey, they're trying to have peace, but they keep getting attacked, so they have to stop that. The ceasefire agreements now are temporary. But this peace is eternal that's talked about. Isaiah 9:7, of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. We have never experienced on the outside a peace like that. Because ever since the garden, there has been a lack of peace. There has been no peace. But God says that he sent the Prince of Peace, and that what's going to accomplish it? It says the zeal of the God of God Almighty will accomplish this eternal peace. And just like the video said, a promise is only as good as who gave it. And God gave this promise, and who's going to accomplish it? It's not going to be in our efforts to make peace. Rather, God is going to accomplish this eternal peace. And so, what does this look like? How can we look at the Prince of Peace and say, okay, how can we see this peace in an individual life? Right? Not just globally, like we want that, but individually, how can we experience that peace? I want that ultimate peace. And so turn to Colossians chapter 1. Because we're going to see in Colossians chapter 1, not only now, but in the future, how are we going to have that peace? What accomplishes it? This is, starting in verse 15, this is Paul talking about the supremacy of Jesus over all things. Verse 15 says that he is the Son is the image of the invisible God. Skip to verse 19. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile himself to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. Notice in verse 19 that God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. This is the incarnation. This is Christmas, that God sent Jesus, his image, to us. The Son that was sent is the Prince of Peace. And why did he send him? We're going to go to verse 21 and kind of work our way back. But once it says that we were alienated from God. We were his enemies in our minds. And that led to evil and wicked deeds. And the predicament before us is that we are alienated from God. We're enemies of his. And what it says is, even if you don't feel like you're worthy of God's peace with you, we're all in the same boat. We hear it in music. My all-time most hated Christmas song. Last Christmas I gave you my heart, and the very next day you gave it away. Which then just leads this person to make another bad decision. She's going to give it away again. That's certainly going to lead to more fractured relationships. We see it in movies. It's almost always dealing with some level of broken relationship. But see, that's here, right? That's horizontal. But see, the problem stems from and begins with our alienation from God Almighty, the Holy God. And this fact that we're enemies of God, that we're alienated from him, is not just a temporary thing. It's not a casual song or a movie. This is our standing for eternity. We're alienated from God unless something is done. Ephesians says that we can't do anything. We're dead in our sins. We're alienated. We've run. We've rebelled. But God, it says, was pleased to send Jesus in order to reconcile to himself all things. He was pleased to do that, to send Jesus to reconcile to himself all things. How? By making peace with us by the shedding of his blood on the cross. This is the story of Christianity. God takes the initiative and comes to earth, to us. And the Prince of Peace dies for those that are opposed to him, and prays for the forgiveness of his enemies. It's why this peace can't be attained by saying, we'll work it out. We can earn it. Because we can't work it out. We're in that help. We need somebody, and that somebody is Jesus, the Prince of Peace, who God is saying through Paul that he is moved toward his rebellious creation and is going to reconcile the relationship that has been severed by our rebellion. This is where we find ourselves at the apex of the Christian claim. Because it is here Paul is making sense of the phrase from Isaiah chapter 9 that he is the Prince of Peace. How is he doing that? Because he is the prince who by his sacrificial death atones for our sin. He takes on him the righteous response of God to sin. That his wrath, he hates sin. His righteous wrath is on sin. And this prince atones for that. He comes and from this point on, he moves towards his death on Calvary. And then he bears our sins on his body. This is propitiation, a big word that Jesus takes our place. He takes my place. And he took my place. And he took your place so that the good news of what the angels proclaim to the shepherds provide peace for all who believe. Peace with God for eternity. And so the question is, do you know that peace? Do you know that you have peace with God? Are you of the, we can work it out? I can earn it. I know I don't have peace, but I can do enough. I can make do with what I have. It's not that bad. Or have you come to the realization that, help, I need somebody because I can't do it. That you need someone outside of yourself to rescue you. But it isn't just peace with God for all of eternity, that's amazing, but it also doesn't end there, because it says that he has reconciled all things to himself. Creation is groaning, Romans 8 says. It's not as it should be. There's hurricanes, there's snowstorms with 7 feet. It's not as it should be. And so there's a future sense to what Jesus accomplished as the Prince of Peace. I love Revelation chapter 21. It was a verse that, you know, with my daughter, and she has her pacemaker, so it's always going to be a part of her story and her life. And so I love Revelation 21. It says this, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. For the old order of things, or the old things, have passed away. I don't think I have verse 5 up there, but verse 5 says, he who is seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. And he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. Remember, a promise is only as good as the one who gives it. And God is promising that he is going to make all things new. That not only as a child of God, somebody who's been, was alienated and God rescued them, we have a right relationship with God, but he's going to make all things right one day. So do you know that peace? If you do, in the here and now, we're to be peacemakers. Right? Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, not peacekeepers, but those that make peace, that enter in to difficult situations, to make peace with others. Whether it be in your homes, husbands, are you initiating the process of making peace and restoring peace? Dads, are you entering into that process? Are you initiating it? You're not sitting back and waiting. But if you have peace with God, we've been called to be peacemakers And so, men, we need to be stepping into and initiating restoring peace. Or to be peacemakers, students in our schools. The amount of chaos in people's lives, or the lack of peace that your friends experience. If you are a follower of God, if you've been rescued, you are called to be a peacemaker in those relationships. You have responsibility in your workplaces to be a peacemaker, an ambassador for Christ, making the appeal to others to be reconciled to God, because the Prince of Peace has come. There is the promise of peace is there. I don't know where you are in your journey in life. But if you don't have a restored relationship, if you don't have peace with God, you can do that today. The offer is there. It's not about your worthiness. It's not about your ability. You can't work it out. But Jesus did. And the offer, that good news is for all people. And there could be peace on those with whom God's favor rests. God's favor is available to you by you humbly saying, I can't do it. I need help. I need salvation. I need your peace. The offer is there. That's why we exist as a church, as this group of people that come here on Sundays and gather other times. That's why we exist. We exist to proclaim what God has done in our lives and in rescuing and taking somebody who is an enemy of Him and making us friends and sons and daughters. And if you do know the Prince of Peace, you have that restored relationship with God, then what we're to do is to go into our world and proclaim it. Just like Pastor Jeff said at the beginning, when they had seen Him, the shepherds, they spread the word concerning what had been told about them, or about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. We have peace with God. We know that God is going to make all things new. He is going to restore everything. We have that hope as followers of God, those that have been rescued. And I wonder how many that are out in Batavia and in the surrounding communities, how many you work with, that we can recognize that there isn't peace. And they can recognize it, and yet they don't know about what the Prince of Peace did. And yet God, through dirty, stinky shepherds, they went out and told all that God had done. And people were amazed at it. That's why we're here. That we would proclaim, that we would tell people that the Prince of Peace has come, and you can have peace with God for all of eternity. Let's be people that are all about that and proclaim God's peace this Christmas season. Let me close in prayer. Father, we thank You that You didn't leave us, but that You initiated and sent Jesus to be, to take our place, to be the Prince of Peace that would allow us to have a right and restored relationship with You, that we can still experience the hostility and the struggles of a sin-cursed world, but we know that we have peace with you, and we look forward to the day where you make all things new. Thank you for letting us be a part of it. May we be people that don't hold that so closely, that we don't just go through our days, but that we are sharing, that we're opening our hearts, our homes, our lives to people to be able to tell them about the Prince of Peace who has come and how they can have that as well. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Like I said, we have been all about that since the church began here. And Pastor Shirk has been doing that for over 35 years. And to give that perspective, I'm 36. So that's a long time. And we're going to be transitioning. The transition team, or Caleb from the transition team, is going to come and talk about how we can still use you and to honor Pastor Shirk.
Good morning. So if you don't know me, my name is Kayla Cassidy. I'm one of the members of the transition team, and I just wanted to give a couple of extra details off of what Ken talked about last week. So if you received the mailing, you would have received an invitation that looks like this, with a QR code at the bottom for the formal dinner that we will be having on January 7th. If you are able to scan that code and purchase your tickets online, we'd encourage you to do that. But if that's not your forte, transition team members will be in the foyer today, and you can buy your tickets with us, or you can come stop in at the church office during the week and see Cindy, and we'd be happy to help you with that. We can't hold tickets, so in order for you to reserve your spot, you have to purchase them on the spot, so just keep that in mind. Martha will talk more about that next week, but just keep that in mind, because tickets are first come, first served. And then in that mailing, you also should have received a sheet that looks like this. And this is a great sheet with details on it and a QR code at the bottom, but the QR code doesn't work. So technology is a beautiful thing when it functions the way that you want it to. But that's okay. If you got that and you were hoping to get more details from that QR code, we have the document that was attached to it in the foyer. So you can stop and come see one of us, and we'll give you those details. And that's what I wanted to expound upon a little bit right now. That document has different ways that you can help us and be a part of honoring the Shirks in a special way. So there's three different things that you can help us with. One is a little photo book. And this is for those of you who might not feel comfortable talking, but you have something you'd like to write and say. I would love if you could write out a brief message and send a photo, maybe of your family or of a special memory you have with the Shirks, if you could send that to me. My email is on that document. You can send it to me that way. Or if you're like, yeah, I do not know how to send an email over with a picture and all that stuff, that's fine. Come see me. You can bring a hard copy of a picture. You can bring a hard copy of your written note, and I will put it all on the computer for you. That is due today. But it's okay. Technically is not due until next week. So if you could please bring anything hard copy by next Sunday, or you can drop it off at the church during the week and I'll get those things from Cindy, that would be super appreciated. If you're able to email those things to me, like I said, come get one of these sheets and it has my email for you. The second thing is the video message. So if you're not a writer, but you're very comfortable talking in front of a camera. Some people were asking, do I send you the video? What do we do with it? You're going to see Zach or myself, and we're going to set up a time to meet with you, and we will record you. So that way everything is the same format, and it's easier for us to put together at the end. All you need to do is set up a time with one of us and prepare a very brief message to say on camera. So that's that one. And then the third one is, if you're not really a talker or you're not a writer, but you have a giftedness in creativity and visual presentations, then the creative display would be something for you. I'm not going to talk too much about what that is, because we want it to be a little bit of a surprise, but if you have questions about what that might look like or some examples, you can see myself in the foyer or Caitlin Rigdon, and we'll give you some help with that. So at the end of all this, if you have any questions, come see one of us transition team members, and they will point you at least in the direction of a person who can help you. Thanks.
Yeah. All right, well, you are not dismissed. You are now sent to go tell others about the Prince of Peace. Have a great Sunday.